Welcome to Crash Concepts, where the economy, energy, and the environment are explored. Up next, fresh ideas and insights into the factors that are driving the world and shaping your future. Presenting information you can't afford to live without, here's Chris Martinson.
Welcome, everyone, to this Peak Prosperity Podcast. I am your host, Chris Martinson, and it is August 21st, 2018. Welcome to the dog days of summer. You've heard me say this before. We are living through the most extraordinary period of monetary printing in all of human history. It's widespread, it's delusional, and yet one of the most enduring mysteries of this period of money printing is that every single asset, except commodities, has been raging higher in price. Stocks, bonds, real estate, high-end art, rare jewels, vehicles, as well as private jets, all ridiculously expensive. Which is maybe not a surprise, given that in 2006, before the ill-advised money printing spree by central banks, there were 793 billionaires in the world worth $2.6 trillion. Today, there are 2,206 billionaires with a combined net worth of $9.1 trillion. Okay, that explains the pricey art, the rare cars, the jets, trophy properties, but it doesn't help us understand the seven-year-long bear market in commodities, which coincidentally began almost to the week, I should say, that the U.S. Federal Reserve embarked on the historically monstrous QE3 program, amounting to an astonishing $85 billion of thin air money per month injected directly into the markets and maybe not entirely indirectly into the billionaire bank accounts. So, how do we make sense of gold and silver and other key commodities languishing and suffering during the most extreme period of money printing and negative real interest rates in history, which have both traditionally been associated with rising, not falling, but rising commodity and gold prices? All right, that's why we've brought a very special guest back today to this program. He's got a career spanning four decades in the investment markets. Brien Lundin serves as president and CEO of Jefferson Financial, a highly regarded publisher of market analyses and producer of investment-oriented events, which we will get into in a minute. Under the Jefferson Financial umbrella, Brien publishes and edits Gold Newsletter, a cornerstone of precious metals advisory since 1971. Hey, there's that date again. Who can tell me what 1971 is? Pop quiz. And hey, he's one of the most respected newsletter writers in the business. Brien also hosts the New Orleans Investment Conference, one of the most well-attended and one of my favorite and dynamic investing conferences that's been running for over 40 years now. So without further ado, let's welcome Brien to the show. Brien, great to have you back.
Great to be with you, Chris. What a wonderful introduction. I was dying to chime in over and over again. You're making so many great points.
Well, which one caught you? Was it the fact that we have nearly 1,500 more billionaires in just the past 10 years? That's a pretty astonishing thing to achieve.
Well, that's one of them, yes. You know, down here we have, in New Orleans, we have this great flood protection that we built up against hurricanes, which was much needed, by the way.
Yeah.
So we have this great protection, and it reminds me of Wall Street and what happened after 2008. And they built a great big protection for Wall Street from all of this market volatility, all of the problems that the central bank, that the Federal Reserve had created. As long as you're within that levee system, you're fine. If you're outside of that levee system, if you're outside of Wall Street, you're out of luck. And that's exactly what happened. You know, Wall Street, all the money, all the wealth effect that they generated by pumping out all of this liquidity, all of this money, 5,000-year lows on interest rates, everything they did pumped up financial assets and made winners out of the people who could afford to position themselves. At the same time, you have earnings for regular Joes out there actually went down. They got the short end of the stick, and Wall Street again and Federal Reserve once again protected the wealthy. It's just crony capitalism on steroids.
Well, you know, Brien, in that line of thinking, and I get accused of being perhaps reading too much into things, and you know, sometimes people say, Chris, you know, just lick your wounds. Markets are markets. You know, maybe you guessed wrong. But to me, it was entirely too convenient for the central banks, particularly the U.S. Federal Reserve, in 2011. Remember, we were just coming off. We had Arab Spring riots. The world wheat prices were up. There was a lot of political pressure over the fact that money printing was creating a lot of political strife in the form of inflation, particularly food inflation around the world. And it was in that same year the New York Federal Reserve moved its trading desks to co-locate them over in Aurora, Illinois, which happens to be where the Chicago Mercantile Exchange runs all of the futures options trading for most of the key commodities in the world. It just struck me as coincidental and rather fortunate for the central bank that during the time they started their largest money printing ever, that marked nearly to the week the exact moment the commodities began a very long, slow, languishing decline. It struck me as odd at best, but it would, knowing what I know now, watching the political cycle happen, watching how corruption has really pervaded the whole system, it would not surprise me in the slightest, Brien, to discover that central banks and their proxies have an interest in trying to nudge the right prices in the right direction and the wrong prices in the wrong direction to serve policy aims. Is that unthinkable here in 2018? Am I still just a cranky guy?
Well, you probably are. you probably are a bit of a curmudgeon, but you know, I plead guilty to that as well after all these years in the business. But you know, Chris, when people ask, is the government involved in manipulating the gold price to some extent? And I'm not a big believer that they do it on a daily basis. I just don't think they have the capability or the expertise, that they're just too ham-handed to manage the price on a daily basis, although they probably have, or the market is set up for certain surrogates to be able to do that. But I think the burden of proof for anyone who wants to say that the gold market isn't manipulated, the burden of proof is on them, because the government manipulates other markets. It manipulates the stock market. We know that for sure. It manipulates interest rates, which is the price of money, and therefore is the price of everything. The government has also manipulated gold, both overtly and covertly, three times in American history. It did so in 1933 when it devalued the dollar against gold by 69% in one day. It did so in the 1960s with the London Gold Pool when it tried to manage the gold price down during the times of guns and butter. And it did so with Treasury gold auctions in the 1970s, which was another blatant attempt to drive the gold price down and get people out of the gold market. So they've done it three times so far. They manipulate every other market. So I think, again, the burden of proof is on anybody who wants to say the government doesn't manipulate the gold price. I think they do at key junctures in the markets, just as they do for every other market. I don't think gold is necessarily special in that regard. Mm-hmm. I just think the government does that.
I would agree with that, and I like that you use the word surrogates, because there certainly are surrogates. Perhaps, I don't know, Ben Bernanke left the chairmanship of the Federal Reserve. Great Freudian slip on that, so I'll leave that one in. And joined Citadel, you know, which is a company that does high-frequency trading and is responsible for up to 20% of the daily U.S. NYSE trading volume. It's just a monster of a company. Optically, a horrible move, but we know that behind the optics, there's probably some real fire with that smoke. And so let me give you maybe a fourth event to throw in there. Brexit happens, right? Surprise vote, nobody expecting it, really sort of a black swan event. Gold starts to spike. And Dave Fairtex, who writes this amazing gold and silver precious metals commentary and generalized market commentary as well for our site, he and I had been going back and forth, and he'd been sort of saying, Chris, you know, a little bit too curmudgeonly. I don't really see, you know, it's not possible for somebody to really influence the trend long term. Maybe they step in now and then. But Brexit happens. He's following this like a hawk and notices that the slamming of gold that happened after that initial spike was accomplished with 50,000 contracts pushed into the market to sell. 50,000 on the dot, not 50,128. It was like this round number, you know? And so and then there were two other events that sort of come along with that. Again, maybe not daily, but there are these round number events which just mysteriously show up at the right moment to, you know, calm the markets. Would you maybe consider those as sort of somebody with an official interest, surrogate or otherwise, that might be stepping in at key times?
Well, perhaps an official interest, perhaps a profit interest, because they certainly make money on doing so. You know, in April of 2013, we saw two attacks in the gold market on two successive trading days, a Friday and a Monday. And in the first attack, it took some 140 tons of gold contracts, nominal gold contracts traded within, I believe, less than 10 minutes. I believe it might have been 8 minutes. And to do that, you would have to have 11 actors, 11 traders, each with a max 3,000 contracts deciding at the exact same moment to do these precisely the same trade. Now, you can ask the CFTC what were the results of their investigation of that episode, because they investigate a lot of curious trading phenomena here and there. So if you ask them what the result was of their investigation of that event, which obviously needed investigation, their response would be, what investigation? Because they didn't. They didn't even look at it. They didn't even bat an eye, because it was gold. And that took the gold price down, I believe, $200 over a couple of days. And that was the big smash that we saw in the gold price after it had peaked in 2011. So it happens all the time. And the high-frequency trading that you had mentioned is another aspect of it. I think that's typically done for profit. But it's an amazing thing that if a large, deep-pocketed trader with the right algorithms, the right black boxes, if they pick the right time in the market and the right market, gold happens to be, pardon the pun, a Goldilocks market. It's just the right size to be able to move with the right shoving a significant degree. But we've seen over and over again that the gold market has been targeted by high frequency traders. And in a thinly traded time window, they'll dump about $100 million worth of shorts onto the market, completely overwhelm it, drive it down about $20, then reverse course, go long, and ride it right back up. And in the course of about 10 minutes, we've seen episodes where high-frequency traders who can put $100 or $120 million to work can make a half a billion or $1 billion in trading. And this has happened over and over again in the gold market.
And to be fair, I've seen it happen in other markets as well, yes, outside of precious metals. I've watched it happen in oil. I've watched it happen in grains. I've seen it in other metals that are non-precious. I mean, would you agree it's sort of like a market structure issue now that the computers kind of own the price of things now?
Yeah, it absolutely is. And there's a guy, Eric Hunsader, I believe it's H-U-N-S-E-D-E-R, who runs Nanex, N-A-N-E-X, which is a supplier of data streams to the investment industry. And they track things tick by tick by tick. And Eric has done a great job of forensic analysis of these episodes. And he'll go in and figure out the exact lot sizes that have been traded to put stress on the circuit breakers, but never really trip them. And the algorithms go in and they test it and they find what their limits are. And it may be some random number of, say, 916 contracts or something like that that's traded in succession. That puts enough pressure on the system, but doesn't trigger the circuit breakers, so they maximize their profits. You're right, it's done in market after market, and I think it's just a sign of this day and age and the information flow and how the real fundamentals are no longer at play in these markets, at least over the short term.
And that's really the crux of this. So the opposite side of this is that, so these are people who are trading, they do it because they make money at it. And I would submit to you, and I'd like your opinion on this, but again, just an opinion, that if we had seen the opposite, if we'd seen in that April 2013 event where some crew came in and all of a sudden just did the opposite of the short event, went long, spiked gold up by $200, I happen to think there would have been an investigation. Would you agree with that?
Oh, absolutely. And I think that's important that there wasn't such an event. So if you look at key times in the market where you may look to see if there has been some type of an official manipulation, that is one that really pops out, because there wasn't, they didn't turn the trade around immediately and go long after they created the big waterfall pattern. They left the market back where it was, so that seemed to be somewhat of their intent. And in fact, selling gold and so quickly at such levels is not a profit maximizing exercise. So their intent was not to maximize profits. Their intent was to basically drive the gold market down.
Yeah. And so, again, if somebody had come along and attempted to do that in the reverse direction, I think there would have been an official response. It was like, oh, you can't do that. So it just sort of it. And again, so when people say to me, hey, Chris, you know, they can't, maybe they could do like little manipulations now and then, but they can't change the direction of a market. And I disagree, because markets are composed of sentiment as much as supply and demand. And so if this happened to me, Brien, imagine that like randomly, three times last year, somebody had put like clear stretch fabric plastic across my front door, and I tripped and fell painfully down my front stairs three separate days as I was going to my car. It's true, they can't change my behavior long term, but guess what? I'm going to step very carefully over my front door and stoop, you know, every time going forward, because I've been trained. I think market sentiment can be clubbed into submission. And I actually think that that's sort of what we're talking about here, is that market sentiment really has been harmed. And I know that more anecdotally by talking to the people that, like myself, who I've talked, they said precious metals is an important part of your portfolio, and they've been in it, but it's been a painful 7 to 8 years now. So would you agree with the idea that sentiment itself can be damaged over time if the markets are operating in, say, random, if not unfair ways?
Well, absolutely. And I think mainstream investment analysis, or, you know, the mainstream research that you get out of Wall Street, is typically that gold is not where you want to be. I mean, they jumped on cryptos so quickly, and all you saw was analysis saying, well, crypto is the new gold, and now gold actually is the barbarous relic because it's been supplanted by technology. So, I absolutely believe that. But I do believe that everything has its turn, and at some point, we're going to see the gold market turn again, and we're going to see an appreciation for gold as insurance and really as a tool for protection from government's inevitable mismanagement of the currency. We're going to see that at some point. It could be very soon, actually.
And why? So I would agree with very soon. Let's talk about some of the reasons why. First, before we get into maybe the big picture, which is official mismanagement, let's talk market structure for a moment. I know that you follow this very, very carefully, really admire and respect your long-term insights into this. Let's talk about the actual structure of what's going on with the paper gold market right now as it stands. That's where the price is set, for better or worse. Hey, maybe there's people sort of like, you know, running the stops for their own private gain or whatnot, be that as it may. That market consists of a number of big players you have to pay attention to. Who are those big players in the gold paper market right now, and how are they positioned?
Well, in the broadest sense, the paper gold market is divided by the Commodity Futures Trading Commission into four or five large groups, but the big players are on one side, the large speculators, and on the other side, the large commercials. Now, the large commercials historically have been the people involved in the market. In the agricultural commodities, it would be, for instance, the big farmers or farming cooperatives. In the metals, typically, it's the jewelers and people who use metals in their everyday business, so they have to hedge the price. However, a lot of these people in the business, in the metals business, have turned to the big bullion banks like J.P. Morgan, et cetera, to do their hedging for them. So now you have these big bullion banks on the commercial side who also have proprietary trading desks. So the picture gets a little fuzzy, it gets a little murky, in that the large commercials are not just the companies, the groups that are involved in the business that need precious metals as part of their fashioning of their products, et cetera, but also these big bullion banks that have trading desks. On the other side, you have large speculators that are hedge funds, institutions, and the like that get involved in the metals, basically just placing bets one way or the other. What we found over time is that the large speculators typically get the direction of the market wrong. It's the commercials, whether because they're smarter or because they manipulate the market to their wishes, are typically right on the direction of the market. And we've seen the large speculators over time get very long, in which case the commercials dump shorts on the market and swamp the large speculators on that end of the market, or we see the large speculators get much less long or even short. And at that point, the commercials come in, they buy, and they send the gold price up. When that happens, the large speculators have to cover their shorts desperately, and we have really steep, very aggressive moves upward in the precious metals, particularly gold and silver. So you want to look at the extremes when the large speculators are historically long or when they're historically short. What's happened very recently is that the large speculators, for the first time since 2001, have actually gone net short. And that's important because in 2001, the last time this happened, we saw the gold market turn around and embark on a multi-year bull run that made absolute fortunes for people who were positioned not only in the metals, but in the right junior mining stocks. I can tell you that during that period, there were companies that we recommended in Gold Newsletter that went up 4, 5, 10, even 20 and more times in value. It was just an incredible time to make money. And if past form holds true, we may be seeing the market turning toward that kind of a long run once again.
So that's interesting. You know, 2001, coincidentally, that was the first year that I really started investing in precious metals myself, and I didn't know anything about the Commitment of Traders report at that time, and which traders were positioned how or what. I might have gotten lucky, but what I was really doing was I was looking at what was happening monetarily. So if we look at this bigger picture now, and you know, I add up some of the features that I think are really important for the price of precious metals and things like that. One of them that comes up consistently for me, besides negative real interest rates, which is for sure a deal, is a pretty good correlation with deficit spending by the U.S. government. Ooh, we're just in a sea of red ink now, aren't we, Brian?
We really are. We're getting to the point now where we're having trillion-dollar deficits once again. And that's the big issue. You know, debt is money. The problem that we're facing today is that the debt is so large that we can no longer have so-called normal interest rates. We can never again get to, you know, 5 or 6% interest rate levels, because at those levels, just the interest on our debt would amount to between $850 and $1 trillion a year. And that's politically impossible. It's fiscally impossible. We cannot pay that much in interest alone, especially with most of that, or at least much of it, going to China. So we will never have 4, 5, 6% interest rates again. Right now, the Federal Reserve is desperately trying to get rates up to the 2.5 to 3% level, just so they have enough room to cut them in the next inevitable recession. And that's where they're going to stop. They've even admitted that 2.5 to 3% is their terminal rate. That's where they're going. And what people don't realize is that if we're getting maybe one rate hike a quarter, that means that we may be done, or the Fed may be done with this rate hikes by the end of this year or by mid-year next year. It's that close, and the market is going to start looking ahead for that point very soon.
Now, this is, you know, as far as I'm concerned, you know, you're just a sea of red ink. It has been gold-friendly in the past, and for pretty good obvious reasons. But this is, we're looking now at a world where Turkey's falling apart, you know, Argentina, Lord only knows what's about to happen there. But last I saw, the Argentinian peso hit 30 to the dollar. It was 16 when I was just there last year. So just really astonishing things happening in emerging markets. So it really feels like there's enough uncertainty, because gold is, to me, more than anything, Brian, a hedge against financial uncertainty and systemic issues as much as it is anything. Inflation, not as much. You won't find me asking a lot of questions about how's inflation doing, because gold is an inflation hedge. I don't have it in my data series where it says that's that great correlation, but it does correlate pretty well with negative real interest rates and deficit spending, and as well financial accidents and things like that. Well, what do you, as you look across the world with your experience, you know, where are we in this story of financial expansion versus risk and all that other stuff?
Well, let's look at a couple of things. You know, the old adage that the stock market isn't the economy, that's no longer true, because the stated goal of the Federal Reserve since 2008 was to create a wealth effect where they pumped up financial assets and tried to create this wealth effect that would lift household wealth out of the doldrums. Well, they did that. They pumped up financial assets in the midst of the expansion of the monetary supply, or actually the Federal Reserve balance sheet. The correlation with the S&P 500 was on the order of 97%. Now the Fed is taking the punch bowl away. It's actually shrinking its balance sheet. So the question now is, are we going to see the same kind of correlation on the downside? As it withdraws this liquidity from the market, is the stock market, is this U.S. economy that has been built upon the foundation of easy money, is it going to collapse? Now, I don't know and I don't predict that we're going to have a collapse in the stock market anytime soon. I think we're probably going to have a recession within the next few years. It's just time. It's just the nature of the business cycle. But I know that if either of those events occur, and when either one occurs, the Federal Reserve will have to come back in and reliquify the markets and therefore the economy that it has built up. It's going to have to do that, and it's going to have to do it to a greater degree than it ever did before. Now, quantitative easing was unprecedented. We'd never seen anything like it in the history of the U.S. economy, and in fact, in the history of the global economy, in the history of the world. We'd never seen that kind of money creation and liquefaction of the economy. The next time they do it, the patient has grown or developed a tolerance to that drug to some degree. So the next time they do it, they're going to have to do it to a much greater degree than they did before, than even with quantitative easing version 3. They're going to have to come back in and really flood the markets. And when that happens, gold is going to soar. In fact, I believe that when the Federal Reserve indicates to the markets that it's just done raising rates, that's going to add $100 or $200 to the gold price in very short order.
Well, let's talk about that price of gold then. You know, just under $1,200 today as we're recording this. 4 months ago, I'm looking at my charts here, $1,350 an ounce. Hey, it's been just sort of almost a ruler straight march down. What are you attributing that to? Is that of all the things we've got? People don't like gold anymore. The dollar got stronger. What are you attributing to that particular decline?
I think to a large degree, it's a typical summertime slump. We see this is a very common occurrence during the summer in the gold market. Since really about 2001, I've tracked every summertime market and looked at it very closely and found that when we do have a slump in the summer, and which is, again, quite frequent, the gold market typically bottoms somewhere between mid-July and mid-August. So we're overdue right now for a rebound, for a bottoming in the metals. I think this year it's been delayed and exacerbated a bit by both the trade war and this spat with Turkey, which has happened just over the last couple of weeks. You know, if you look back to as recently as last week, there were fears that the crash in the Turkish lira was going to spread to other emerging market economies, and we were going to have, you know, that kind of contagion that everybody's fearful of, that would create a global recession. That hasn't happened. It still may, but those fears have been somewhat alleviated. So I think that combination of the trade war and more recently the issues of Turkey have kind of extended this downturn in gold. But again, we're looking at a lot of technical indicators. We're looking at some fundamental indicators that seem to argue that if we're not bottoming at this very moment as we're talking in gold, then within the next 2 or 3 weeks, it's very likely to happen.
And would you apply any different analysis to silver, which I'm looking at has a very tight correlation with copper, both of them having been clubbed starting since mid-June, about a month later than when gold started to go down. What's your take on silver? And are we looking at this as more an industrial metal than gold as a monetary metal?
I look at it as a monetary metal, much like gold. Silver is a smaller market. It's more volatile. So it's a little bit easier for people, for large players to play some games in. But my feeling is you analyze gold first. If you think gold is going to go up, then you buy silver. In short, if you like gold, you have to love silver. It's basically an option play on gold. It moves further than gold and in the same direction as gold, both up and down. Now, I think that the argument that silver is also an industrial metal is really irrelevant. If silver was valued purely on its industrial value, it would be about $5 or $6 an ounce. Everything above that is purely monetary. And that's where the vast majority of the demand comes from and will come from. It's always at the margins. And at the margins, it's the monetary demand that drives the price for both metals.
All right. Well, most silver is coming as a byproduct of base metal production. But let's look now. I'm looking at here at the three big gold miners that I'm tracking here, Newmont, Barrick, and Goldcorp. They saw production fall 15% in the first half of 2018 compared to a year earlier, and costs rose such that the combined free cash flow for these three entities fell from $718 million last year, first 6 months, to $38 million this year. And now gold and silver having gone down further here into the second half, it seems to me the mining industry is also getting clubbed here pretty hard.
Yeah.
Give us your take on the miners, majors, juniors, and how are they really doing? Some of them seem to be, if these big guys are having so much trouble with free cash flow, the little guys must just be, really having trouble, I would think.
Well, yes, they are. But the big guys have not been able to replace reserves, and they're not able to replace even production by building up their reserves. In fact, there's very clear evidence that we've reached peak gold. If we didn't reach it last year, if we're not reaching it this year, then it's going to happen next year. We basically plateaued and are starting on the other side of the hill with global gold production actually declining. I think that's a very important, obviously an important factor for the gold market going forward. The other issue, though, that I believe is that when you invest in gold, you're investing in the certainty that, you don't know if there's all of a sudden going to be some big supply of gold or somebody's going to dump gold onto the market. Maybe Turkey or Russia for some reason decides to dump gold in the market. You don't know if that's going to happen, but I think that's a moot point. The big point that you're looking for when you're investing in gold is that there will always be more fiat currencies and a greater increase in fiat currencies than there will be in the gold supply. You can bet on that. You can bank on that. And you need to be prepared for that, because over the long term, that's what drives gold prices much higher. You know, Chris, you mentioned that there's not a clear correlation between the rate of inflation and gold, that gold doesn't perform very well as an inflation hedge. I think if you look at certain periods, starting and ending points, you can make that argument very clearly. But if you look at the very long sweep of history, for instance, if you look at 1965, when the U.S. took silver out of coinage, from that point to today, the U.S. dollar has lost 88% of its purchasing power by the government's own statistics. Over that same point, you can see that the price of gold has gone up from $20 an ounce to as much as $1,900 an ounce. A lot of wiggles along the line, but the important point is the price of gold has gone from the lower left to the upper right, while the purchasing power of the U.S. dollar has gone from the upper left to the lower right. And so over the long sweep of history, That's why you buy gold. That's why you need physical metals, because this kind of these trends are inevitable. It's not just the United States. It's not just the U.S. economy and the Federal Reserve. It's every central bank, and in fact, every civilization throughout history where the currency has eventually been debased.
And as we all know, in our heart of hearts, given the choice between allowing everything to collapse into the deflationary hole it wants to fall into or printing more, we all know that QE4 or 10 or whatever number we put on it is coming, right?
Oh, absolutely. Central bankers are raised from pups to fear deflation. It's really at a cellular level, they fear inflation, and they will open up the floodgates of liquidity.
That's deflation.
Deflation. I don't worry about a deflationary depression or a deflationary breakdown, because I know that central bankers will be able to just absolutely flood the economy with new currency. They've already done it, like we said, with QE 1, 2, and 3. And QE 4 is going to make QE 3 pale by comparison. You can bet on that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I'm going to call that one money for Main Street. Been waiting for it for a long time. My advice to people, when, not if, but when that moment comes, is to run, not walk, to the nearest things you can spend your fiat currency on. And of course, being pre-positioned for that would be really important, because another point I think that sort of got lost here is that the gold market for retail people is not very big, gold and silver, meaning that if push comes to shove and 5% of the population wakes up and says, I want to have gold or silver, I don't think there's enough retail product out there for most people to get their hands on it. So my advice to people has been, be a year early rather than a day late to that story. If you want to have exposure to precious metals, you got to get in on it early. Otherwise, you'll be left scrambling for paper representations of that. Not what you want, when that time comes.
Yeah, we've seen many times where you cannot buy gold or silver. There's just no physical supply out there. And if you can find it, you have to wait weeks or even months to get a hold of it. So it is important. And at low prices like we have today, you know, the smart investors look at gold and silver as being on sale right now.
Well, absolutely. And if push came to shove and we had 2,206 billionaires out there and 15 of them decided they wanted to put their money in silver, well, there's no more left in the world. Obviously, price would rise before that. But there's only maybe $15 billion worth of silver floating around out there for investors. It's such a small number. It's just ridiculous in the context of trillions and trillions being out there looking for something to do.
Absolutely. Get it now while you can and while it takes less dollars to get it.
Absolutely. So, hey, in the time we've got left, I want to turn to the New Orleans Investor Conference. And would that be all right with you?
I think so.
Absolutely. So so tell us about the New Orleans Investment Conference this year. What's the theme? Who's coming? Adam and I will be there, obviously, but I'm just super excited for this year's conference.
Well, we're excited to have you, and Adam, you've been such a tremendous addition to our event our attendees are so we're just blown away by your presentations and your appearances last year and the value you bring to the event. And, you know, they're pretty good judges. This will be our 44th annual event. It was actually started by my mentor, Jim Blanchard, who was popularly known as the original gold bug. He started it in 1974 after he was instrumental in getting gold legalized for U.S. citizens. Between 1971 and 1974, he advocated and organized a bunch of protests and some crazy events to try and get gold legalized. That happened in 1974. Before it happened, he had an investment conference to teach investors how to invest in the metal. And he had hundreds more people than he expected. And since then, we've expanded the event to cover every asset sector, but we've stayed true to our legacy of covering geopolitics and economics with some of the biggest names out there, to some of the smartest experts in the big picture, and then drilling down to gold, precious metals, mining stocks, and the world's top experts in those sectors to give their hottest top picks every year. They always give those at the New Orleans conference, and it's been, as a result, very profitable for attendees.
Of course, the best part for me is meeting all of the other attendees out there. I mean, half the crowd you could put on the stage and learn something, maybe all of them. And in the past, you've had Alan Greenspan as keynote, Margaret Thatcher, Ayn Rand, Gerald Ford, Milton Friedman. Who's going to be there this year? Who have you got lined up?
Well, we have another blockbuster lineup this year we've been able to put together. You know, we have your friend and mine, Robert Kiyosaki, who's mm-hmm. making her appearance this year. He says he has a special treat for us this year that we're looking forward to. He's very excited about it. In fact, Robert sits in the front row with a notepad and fills it up taking notes. He's there every morning and stays late learning from our speakers as well as, you know, his presentations. We also have Mark Stein. We have Jonah Goldberg. We have James Grant. We have Doug Casey. We have Peter Schiff. We have Guy Adami from CNBC. We just signed up. We have Dennis Gartman. We have Rick Rule. We have you guys, you and Adam, and the list just goes on and on. We have literally dozens of the top experts in precious metals and mining stocks as well, and a lot of really good, specific, actionable recommendations are going to be made this year, and I think at a critical point in the markets.
Now, you're actually running a little bit of a contest this year for whoever can drive the most registrants. Can I tell people about that?
Absolutely. For any publishers or market authorities like yourselves who get their readers and attendees and followers to come to the conference, whoever brings the most people is going to get an ounce of gold. So and frankly, we're going to buy that gold now because I think the price is going to be much higher by the time of the conference.
All right. So people, if you're listening, you want to go, do Adam and I a favor and sign up by clicking the link below this podcast, mostly just because we're competitive folks and we'd love to drive more people and we'd love to see you there at this amazing conference. Adam and I will be running some special events there as well as we did last year so that we can get our own tribe together and people who want to meet us and maybe spend a little more time with us. So that would be something we would be interested in doing. And of course, it's an amazing conference. It really is. I met so many high quality people there last year. And it was at your conference where I actually first met the real estate radio guys. And next thing I know, I'm going on these cruises, which have just been absolutely fabulous and instrumental in meeting a whole nother tribe of people. So you got some great tribes of people who show up and we get to rub elbows and meet each other. So that's the real draw for me. Just real high quality people are coming.
You know, I tell people that every year in my opening remarks. I tell them that on the stage is going to be some fantastic speakers, some really inspirational experts with remarkable insights, but that the real value of the conference is when they look to their left and their right and they see their fellow investors in the audience. These people have already identified themselves as being pretty smart just by coming to this event. They've identified themselves as being self-directed, information hungry, active investors, people who know what they're talking about. And that's the real value and part of the real value. And to really encourage that, we have a number of social events during the conference. We bring out the best of New Orleans music and food and ambiance for our attendees. It's just a wonderful experience. There's an intellectual energy that just sparks throughout the hallways. And, you know, as I'm sure you can testify, you can't really describe it. You have to experience it.
You absolutely do. And for everybody listening, this is the first 4 days of November 2018 in New Orleans, right in the French Quarter, if it's the same place as last year. So it's just going to be a fabulous time. All right, Brien, please tell our listeners first, you know, how they can follow your work. And then second, the newsletters that you publish. How can people find those and follow your work more closely?
Well, Gold Newsletter, they can find everything they need to know about it at goldnewsletter.com. The New Orleans Conference, they can click on that link that I'm sure you'll provide in the show notes, mm-hmm. and that will get them a long way toward giving you some gold. So they're going to hopefully they'll do you a solid right there and click on that link and get you some gold. But they can also find out more information by going to neworleansconference.com. And they can always find me on Twitter at Brien Lundin, BRIENLUNDIN. They can, an underscore between that actually on Twitter, but they can just search and find me there. And I hope to see them all this fall in a couple of months in New Orleans.
Well, fantastic. And thank you so much for that. Looking forward to seeing you this fall. And thank you so much for your time today and sharing your extensive gold knowledge with all of our listeners.
Always great to be with you, Chris. Thank you.